Hello everyone, thank you for having me. My name is Simon Weckert. I'm a Berlin-based artist, and in the beginning of the year I did a project which is called Google Maps Hacks, which got a lot of attention in social media, in the news, on television. And today I would like to give you a short introduction and a short insight about the project, what was my motivation, what is the technique behind, and before I'm gonna start with that, I would like to play a short video of the project, especially for the ones which don't know what I'm talking about here. So before I start, just a short introduction to myself, what is my background. I studied art at the University of Art in Berlin, and there I was much more interested into digital computing, coding, electronics, and that's actually also, I would say, what I learned, and that's also what I'm interested in. So basically, in my artworks or in the topics I'm dealing with, I'm super interested in like how technology influence how technology shapes our society. So one of my let's say sentence I'm always kind of following is that at first we shape our tools and then they shape us. At some point I truly believe in that. For example, how it shapes our language when we talk to each other, but also of course how it shapes mobility, how we move in a city, how we interact in society and so on by technology. And those are basically leading questions and topics what I'm trying to understand and to follow, and basically also make people aware of it, what technology means to us, technology means to society, and also make topics specific related to technology, let's say, open or understandable for people which are not so familiar with it. So therefore, one of these projects, or one of the performances I did, was the so-called Google Maps hacks in the beginning of the year. And as you have seen in the video, what I did was basically I used a red wagon, like once for which is actually made for childs, and I used 99 smartphones, put them into in the wagon, and was carrying those wagon behind me in the streets of Berlin. The special thing about it was that on the smartphones, they all were Android smartphones, so basically Google smartphones. There was also Google Maps running on it, but I will come to that a specific point later on, because it might be possible that some of you are interested in like how this technique behind works. But anyway, so basically I was carrying those 99 smartphones behind me in the streets of Berlin, and by doing so I was able to generate a virtual traffic on Google Maps service, or basically in the navigation tool of Google Maps. So I got the idea for that performance during the 1st of May demonstration in Berlin. Basically every year in Berlin, there are on the 1st of May there are huge protests and or basic demonstrations in the city of namely Kreuzberg and Neukölln, where people are going outside in the streets and fighting, protesting for their labor rights. And I think it was like 3 years ago when I went to one of those protests, and during that time I checked my smartphone, also the, in that sense the application Google Maps, and then I realized that in that time that there were a lot of traffic in the streets of Berlin, or in that area where the protests were going on. And then I thought like, oh wow, actually interesting that there is virtual traffic on Google Maps right now, because in fact that there is right now there is no car at all on the street. There are just people walking alongside the street. And then I thought like, wow, that's actually quite interesting to me to see like how Google is generating this virtual traffic. And then I thought like, might it be possible to reproduce that kind of effect? And it was for me quite clear that that I don't need, let's say, a lot of people walking alongside the street. Actually, what I need is their smartphones, right, to generate something similar to this. So this was basically the beginning for me to start, or when it was starting to grow, to think of, okay, can I reproduce something like that by myself? This was then the point where everything started, to think about, okay, how can I reproduce it? And then the whole journey began for me, like, okay, how can I get smartphones like super cheap? What do I need for that? Like, you know, for example, do I need for each smartphone one SIM card, or could it also work with some kind of hotspot? That means that, you know, multiple smartphones are connected to one smartphone, and does it mean that this could also work, that Google believes or thinks that there are, okay, there are, let's say, 10 smartphones, but in fact they are all connected to one SIM card. So that was basically a lot of, you know, backward forward processes and tests going on. I mean, for me the biggest thing was actually to get smartphones in general. I thought it might be quite easy to get secondhand smartphones, but then again I figured out it's actually not that easy. Especially, I mean, you know, in Germany I couldn't find like, let's say, you know, let's say providers which offered them cheap, where you could basically buy them. So what I did was, in the end, I asked a lot of friends if they could rent me their smartphone for 1 day, and I also got a pretty good contract to an official smartphone rental station where you can rent a smartphone for 1 day. And then this was basically the way how I got 99 smartphones. 99 in that sense also stands for the Occupy movement in New York, and of course there's also a link to the JC song 99 Problems. And so for me it was actually after I figured out, okay, actually this hack also works with less smartphones, for me it was pretty much more the question, okay, I need basically some kind of number which is, you know, getting somehow rememberable or notable in social media. And that was the reason why I came up with 99 smartphones. So there's, for example, here an important fact is that you don't need 90 megabyte smartphones. It can also work, for example, with 50. And I have always also seen people, let's say copycats on YouTube, and they use 20, 25 smartphones. So therefore, here it makes sense to point out that it's basically the question where you're gonna want or where you want to produce virtual traffic. So to me, it looks like this: you can use less smartphones to produce a virtual traffic when you are, let's say, on the countryside, compared to when you're in the city with the potential that, let's say, cars are passing by where you're going to carry the wagon with the smartphones behind you. Then it seems to be it makes sense to have more smartphones in the wagon. So that's actually what I learned, or basically what I figured out during my test phase. So yeah, basically, then for me it was like, okay, what I learned is, okay, let's say to produce something like this in Berlin, I learned that I need around 50. But then of course it also came into my mind, okay, I would like to place that somehow, let's say, in the social media. I would like to have some kind of let's say glue that people remember that, and that was the reason and why I came up with 99. So what was my main motivation behind the project? So I would say that there are multiple reasons or motivations behind them, but I think like one of them, or probably the biggest one, is the map in general, in that sense the digital map, and let's say the paradigm change compared to analog maps which we had back in the days. So I mean, imagine that probably if you ask somebody, think about the map, then I would say that for 80 or 90% of the people, what pops out in their mind is probably a digital map, for example, Google Maps, right? But this wasn't always like this, of course, and like back in the days, we had analog printed maps, and those maps have been shaped, those maps have been produced, and those maps have been, of course, let's say, controlled, manipulated as well, by most of the time states and military. So they used it for specific purposes, they used it for an instrument to argue, and I mean, of course, they used it, for example, to divide countries, to divide areas, and they have been used as an instrument for power, for control. And well, regarding this and having a look at the maps we have today, I thought, okay, actually something is going on here, which basically I see as a paradigm change in case of, or with regards to the, let's say, power, to the control, to the influence of those maps. Which means that back in the days we had the military, we had the state, and now we have pretty much more, I would say, private companies which are defining how those maps are looks like. And this to me generates, of course, questions like, okay, we have these maps as digital maps, but then where does those data come from? How transparent is the system? How can I, as a user of those maps, shape it, especially also, let's say, also as well, how can I manipulate it? And how open is the system, especially from a democratic point of view, right? So in that sense, I think it's worth it to have a closer look what digital maps, especially Google Maps, means to us these days, and also how I think it's shaping, how it's influencing our everyday life. So the advent of Google's GeoTool began in 2005 with Maps, Earth, and followed by Street View in 2007. And they have since become enormously more technology advanced. Google's virtual maps have little in common with classical analog maps. The most significant difference is that Google Maps are interactive, scrollable, searchable, and zoomable. And Google's map services has fundamentally changed our understanding of what a map is, how we interact with maps, their technology limitation, and how they look aesthetically. So in this fashion, Google Maps makes virtual change to the real city. Applications such as Airbnb and car sharing have an immense impact on cities, on their housing market and mobility culture, for instance. There's also a major impact on how we find a romantic partner thanks to dating platforms such as Tinder, and on our self-quantifying behavior thanks to the Nike jogging app, or map-based food delivery apps like Deliveroo or Foodora. All of these apps function via interfaces with Google Maps and create new forms of digital capitalism. And without these maps, car sharing systems, new taxi apps, bike rental systems, and online transport agency services such as Uber would be unthinkable. An additional mapping market is provided by self-driving cars. And again, Google has already established a position for itself. With its GeoTools, Google has created a platform that allows users and businesses to interact with maps in a novel way. This means that questions relating to power and the discourse of cartography have to be reformulated. But what is the relation between the art of enabling and techniques of supervision, control, and regulation in Google Maps? Do these maps function as a dispositive net that determine the behavior, opinions, and images of living beings exercising power and controlling knowledge? So, as an example, think about protests, demonstrations in a city. So let's say, I think the main purpose for demonstrations or protests is to interrupt the everyday life of people living in a city, right? So when you go out into the street, you're gonna block the street. And that means you would like to interrupt their usually daily, let's say, business, and to make them aware of something, what you're fighting for, what you're protesting for. So let's imagine that we have a navigation system like Google Maps. That means that cars and, let's say, tourists in cars, people living in the city, driving in the city, are getting rerouted around that demonstration because of this navigation system, because the navigation system is saying you, yeah, actually there is some traffic in front of you, so I'm gonna show you a better route to your destination. But what happened then is that you in a car, sitting in a car, driving in a car, you will never get aware of what happened there in front of you into the street. Like basically what happened there, let's say, when people, let's say farmers, are protesting for better milk prices or so on and so on. So you will never get to know actually what's going on there, because you will actually not get that there are people protesting there in front of you. And that for me is actually a kind of, let's say, dangerous let's say effect, because that means that therefore it's somehow cutting one of our democratic tools we have, which is basically the democratical, or the protest culture, the demonstration culture, where we are able to go out and say something out loud. And I think there I see a kind of a danger what, let's say, Google needs to work on to basically implement this and that into their cities, that even if you are getting rerouted, that you already get some kind of indication why you are basically getting rerouted. So is it because of the traffic, or might it be possible there is, for example, a demonstration going on, and if there's a demonstration going on, what kind of demonstration is it? So I think that's, for example, like a pretty interesting, let's say, side effect which comes up when we're gonna use tools like Google Maps. Another effect that comes with Google Maps service, especially with the traffic feature, is that imagine that there is a highway and there is a traffic. Then the navigation system tells me, okay, I found a shorter, faster route around it. And therefore you will getting rerouted, for example, to a smaller city or let's say an area with smaller streets. And that actually creates or could create much more traffic compared to let's wait 20 minutes, 30 minutes until this traffic got solved. So basically what happened is, and that's a quite interesting, for me, a quite interesting friction what I see there between, let's say, those digital tools and the analog world, is that, for example, our cities, our streets, most of the time, they are not made for a huge amount of, let's say, cars, right? And when we're gonna use these navigation systems and we're gonna get rerouted by those navigation systems to, let's say, smaller cities, that means that the amount of cars which are getting rerouted are actually creating much more traffic in that area because this area is actually not made for that many cars. So therefore, for me, it means that actually it needs to be also something implemented into this services that is also basically realizing, okay, this route actually makes sense to you, but it also realizes that when it's gonna send, let's say, 100 cars there, then it actually will create much more traffic, or it will create much more, let's say, problems in that area compared to say, okay, look, just or basically wait 20, 30 minutes, and this might probably might be better, might be faster for you instead of going the link around it. So these are just a few examples where I think that digital maps will shape our, let's say, way how we move, how we interact, for example, in urban space, in a city, in the near future. And I mean, maybe as another example, as a last example, I would like to give you also, let's say, for, let's say, kind of a future view is that, as we all know, Pokemon Go in the background is also using Google Maps services to locate, basically to locate Pokemons in the area where you are. And there are reports that are saying that there is a cooperation between, for example, restaurants or some kind of, let's say, businesses and Pokemon Go talking to each other through the Google Maps service, to means that, for example, McDonald's talk to Pokemon Go to tell them like, yeah, look, could you probably place pretty raw Pokemons in front of our store? Of course, with the main motivation that the users of those applications will probably have a look or go into the store once they are standing in front of it. So therefore we see that it's not just like this that we are gonna using Google Maps as we know it in an application. It actually also lies behind of a lot of services, and it's gonna be used by, let's say, a lot of things we probably use every day, or like, you know, post delivery. I mean, police is using it, and of course, as I already mentioned, specific delivery services and so on. So therefore, I see a lot of control and power influence by Google when we are talking about like how these tools shaping our everyday life. So this was pretty much more, let's say, my motivation and what I was interested in this project. And now I would like to give you a short insight of what happened when I published the project, and basically, let's say, the afterglow of it, and probably also maybe some kind of stuff like how it went viral and so on. So the thing is, or one important, I think, what I think why it went so viral was one important fact is that is that I published the project 1 week before the 50th birthday of Google Maps. So I was aware of that probably a lot of, or that was quite clear for me that a lot of journalists and newspapers, they will write about the Google Maps birthday. And they will write about something like, okay, yeah, this service has a lot of influence in our everyday life and how it shaped and so on our everyday life. And I wanted also to give those journalists and newspapers, let's say, another view about this about the service, and also somehow, let's say, show them the downside of it. And that was the reason why I published this project 1 week before the birthday, so that they basically could took it into their articles and to write about it. And that was also basically the whole journey, because after I published it, I got like so many interviews and had to write a lot of emails and so on and so on. And and this was actually for me quite a long learning process, like how to deal with this with the media, and also, let's say, how to make it let's say easy understandable as possible for a wider audience. And let's say one of the most the question I got most was that Google, if Google basically wrote me or got in contact with me, and that's not the case, but they gave an statement, I think it was in the Guardian, where they said, where Google's spokesperson said, whether we are car or cart or camel, we love to see creative users of Google Maps, as it helps us to make maps work better over time. And so I think they took it in a kind of sporty way, and basically now I guess they are trying to work on it, that this kind of, let's say, hack doesn't happen in the future. I personally think that they might not be able to fix that, because for example, what I did to, let's say, trick the algorithm was that I was simulating some kind of stop and go behavior with the wagon. That means that I was carrying the wagon behind me, and from time to time I was running, then I was basically standing there going slower, and then basically I had this kind of let's say unregular rhythm during I was walking in the street of Berlin. And what I also did was that I also spent sometimes half an hour or also 40 minutes at one place, and basically was, you know, working forward, backward on one spot, especially for example in front of the Google headquarters in Berlin. So therefore, I think I'm not sure if they are able to track something like this, because when they are able to track some kind of behavior, then it also means that, for example, demonstration or protests might be not being tracked by Google. So basically, I think there are then there is basically this kind of problem for them, because when they are saying they're gonna solve these kind of bugs, it also means that they will not be able to, let's say, track a lot of people walking inside the street, like protests, for example. So therefore, I'm curious to see if Google will solve this problem in the future. And for sure, I will do another test, maybe this year, maybe next year. And I think what's worth it to mention is that, as we know, usually these kind of bugs, I mean, of course we can debate it if it is basically a hack or a bug or not, but of course it's somehow, I would say, let's say, a problem which they have to solve, right? But when, I would say, especially in this kind of techie world, when somebody finds this kind of bugs, right, then they're gonna deal with it in a much more, let's say, behind the curtain situation, right? So basically, a broader audience will not notice something, or basically will never get, let's say, in touch with something like that. And I think what this performance I did makes it unique is that I was using, let's say, a technique, or let's say a metaphor story, which is like super easy to understand for everybody, even if he or she is not familiar with this, let's say, technology in a way. Because, you know, everybody knows Google Maps, and therefore, I guess most of them also basically use those navigation systems. And they can hardly imagine how this kind of basically hack could work, right? Because you have to say that to generate virtual traffic, there are multiple ways. So I also came across with software, or basically with an idea of to write a program, like a little application to do that. But then I thought, yeah, actually, like to make it understandable and to make it readable for a broader audience, it needs to be, let's say, easier in a way to read, because of course, I mean, most of the people, or let's say a lot of people, they for them, algorithms and this kind of stuff is actually too abstract to understand. So, and that was the main reason why I thought, okay, and it needs another technique, it needs another, let's say, story or method to tell the story. And this was also the reason why I've chosen the Red Dragon with the smartphones in it, and not taking the way by to write an yeah to write an algorithm, to write an application which is doing that for me. So I think that's it. I will end my presentation here. I hope it gives you a bit of an insight about the motivation and why I did the project. And I am happy to for Q&A in the chat. And yeah, see you later. Have a great day.